time was to arrive H minus 2 minutes before the actual salt wave. I dashed right through that barrage, never got hit. The shells were popping all over the place. Lying on the beach, so peaceful. And I just got a hold of him, my brother was holding. He says, "Hold me, I'm cold." And then he died within a matter of 30 seconds. My name is Jim Parks, and I was born in Winnipeg. And during the 30s, our older people, our older brothers and friends, they all were joining the reserve forces. But I joined the cadets, the Cameron cadets, and at 10 years of age. And I was still in the cadets when I joined the NPAM Winnipeg Rifles in November 1940. And I stayed in that until July and August of 1941. I went down to the recruiting depot, they were advertising for people for the Cameron Highlanders, and I joined up. And the fellow asked me what my age was, and I said, I told him my age that was acceptable, which is 18, and any proof of age, and I pulled out this selective service card, which they automatically gave to us in the reserve force, for those who, supposed to be for those who are 18 or over. So I showed them this card. And the sergeant said, "That's okay, you had to be 18 in order to have that." But I was still 15 at the time. Well, August, the middle of August, ready to go to overseas. And so the time we got on board boat was the 19th of August, and we were 16 days on board ship, the SS Orbita, heading for England. We landed at Liverpool, England, and we got onto these coaches, and the first stop we made was for tea, and we thought, for tea? You know, the English way, for tea? And I never seen such big mugs, a big mug of tea each, and what I call hard rock cookies. So we got two cookies each, and tea. Oh yeah, when we first got, the different sections I was in, the first thing section they put was the intelligence section, as an observer. And then they moved me to the sniper section, but I wasn't that good a shot. And so then they got over to England. The first job they put me into after about a month, they started reorganizing people. I was sent to the mortar platoon. It was the best move I had ever made, because it was a good bunch of people from Dauphin, Manitoba. They're all from the country. For D-Day, it was the first time that we were allocated to the 6th Field Company of the Royal Engineers. And our job, we had two mortar sections, and our time was to arrive H minus 2 minutes before the actual salt wave, because they anticipated that all the machine guns and the whatever else was there would be wiped out by the bombing and by the shelling, but it so happens nothing was hit. Everything was intact. And so we hit a mine, and we also a shell coming through the front part of the landing craft. But two of the bulldozers got off, and when our two carriers went off into the water, we sank right away. But we knew it was happening and threw off my equipment and jumped and got into the water, and as I swung toward shore, it swung me from right to left. That was the way the wind was blowing. It was a 4-6, and the waves were coming in, and it put us in front of the landing craft coming in. And it's either the landing craft or the wake that caught me on the left shoulder and forced me into the water. And that's when I swallowed a lot of water, and I felt that that was the biscuit. I had the biscuit. You know, you get a panic. And then I sort of touched touch of sand underneath, and I'd give you more adrenaline, and I popped up. So I made my way further in. Meanwhile, Bob was over to the right. He wondered where I was, and he was yelling my name, Jimmy, Jimmy. And we were in mix with the companies, and they were lying in the water. Some guys had been hit, so we just grabbed fellows from the water and pull them into the water and pull them out. And we got quite a few out, and I ended up getting a scene corporal Scaife lying on the beach, and I flopped down beside him, but he was always badly wounded. I think he might have been killed at the time, but he sold him, later on showed a diet of wounds. So I picked up his Sten gun and whatever else I could get off him and made my way to the pillbox. Andrew Eyes was one of the guys who was killed on the beach, and one eye was a little bit cockeyed, so his nickname was Banjo Eyes. He's lying on the beach, so peaceful, but right where the belt line lies is where the intestines are rolled out to him. And he's sitting there with his eyes are open, and one eye cockeyed. Eh? That's how I was able to recognize him so well, Banjo Eyes. Yeah.
And how do you think he became a casualty on the beach?
Pardon?
How do you think he became a casualty on the beach?
Oh, he shot across the belly. Most of the machine gun was sent on filleted to fire along the beach and not anything coming in, probably at an angle.
And fields of crossing fire.
Yeah, so most of the fire, they hope it hits between the knee and the shoulder. That's the best place to aim. So most of them would catch people in the torso. So his was cut across here. And this corporal, this one guy we picked up on the beach is Corporal Martin. And my brother carried him first up to the pillbox where we were. And we took turns holding him because he had froth on the mouth and he had blood on his, spattered us all over. And now I got my turn to hold him, and I just got a hold of him because my brother was holding him. He says, "Hold me, I'm cold." And then he died in a matter of 30 seconds. That was on the beach. One of the guys we picked up, because most of them were dead. Yeah. And the ones who were wounded, okay, we pulled them further enough. But this guy, my brother, for some reason, picked him up because of his moaning. He brought him up to the pill. We were in the shelter of the pillbox. We're there about a half an hour. And an engineer guy came up and he said, "What's it like inside?" We said, "Don't know." He walked in and he came up with five German soldiers. He gave him a sergeant. And they gave him the MM. He got the MM for that. Well, we were already there, but they quietened down. But thank God he gets something. A lot of people got nothing for him. But everything is good deeds going all over the place, right?
In a day's end, the cost at Juno Beach had been extremely high, approaching about 2,000 casualties. Of those 2,000, about 128 were from your regiment.
Yeah, and there's 359 killed on the beach, Juno Beach, yeah. Yeah. So when you go back there, it's hard to imagine. You have to remember what it looks like because it's also cleaned up now. It's also cleaned up.
To the Battle of Normandy proper, your regiment earned battle honors not long after landing in France for actions on June 7th, 8th at Putot-en-Bessin, and this was known as the holding of the Oak Line. On June 8th, Canadian prisoners were interrogated and murdered in cold blood by order by SS Major Gerhard Bremer of the 12th SS Panzer Division's 26th SS Panzer Grenadier Regiment. What are your memories of the regiment's gallant battle at Putot that warm summer day, and the crime that would follow at Fontenay-le-Pesnil?
Well, actually, we were. I was attached to a PN section, Bob Humpy and I, because we lost all our mortars, but they didn't want us integrate us into the companies because they said that we were trained mortarmen and we were expected to get replacement mortars and carriers within a day or two, which never happened. So we were whatever happened. We got that first night. We were dug in an orchard right near the rail line where a bridge went over. It's a famous bridge near Brouet, I think it was. And we were dug in there during the night, and we had the, each section had a carrier, had a trailer loaded with ammunition, 110 rounds of ammunition, and enough food for 3 weeks. Later on the night, I was picked to go on a patrol. We went out for about 20 minutes, and the sergeant came running back. We got to go back, so I went back, and then so I went back to where Pete Enge was. I said, well, he didn't seem to want us anymore, so I'm not going back. And then during the night, around about 3:30 or 5 o'clock, whatever time it was, we heard this tank coming down the road, and we went over to Tommy Plum, the sergeant, and said, Tommy, it looks like tanks. And he was sort of dozing. He said he wasn't. We knew damn well he was, because we had to shake him. He got up and he started firing his rifle at the shadow of the tank. So that was kind of funny, you know, when you think about it. So we said, let's get out of here. And it took so long to get out of here that I thought we were going to get on the run. I said, Bob, let's you and I just take off. We know where B Company is behind us. They forgot. They left us behind. And so we're all by ourselves, because originally we're with B Company. And during that night, we're with B Company, they come in with reinforcements and said, put one in each of your trench with you, because we don't have time to spread them around. So what we did after about a half an hour or so, we dug a good extra trenches for these extra recruits that came in. Because three in a trench is too crowded, right? And these guys are quite nervous. They just come in as reinforcements, and we were nervous enough as it is, but we're considered veterans, could be near to 2 days, right? So so what happened was, when they pulled out that morning, about 5 o'clock, we thought they were not going fast enough. They're trying to hook up the trailer. They ended up, they couldn't hook up the trailer. So they pulled out and left those trailers with ammunition and food in it. But Bob and I went down this frunken road, and we took off to B Company. We beat the carry to B Company by about 30 seconds. But we thought they were going to get caught. And we waited for the carriers, because we could hear the tank coming. And we thought we'd be nailed by them. And in fact, it did turn onto the road that they took. And they managed to get to the sunken road and made a left turn and headed back to B Company just in time, you know. But during the next day, a lot of action ended up around that particular crossing. And when I got back the next, got daylight, and there's a lot of our, we knew there were some attacks going in, we didn't know where. Some patrols or whatever, there's, because there's a lot of mortar fire, 88s. And we got to learn what the 88s were, the ones you couldn't hear coming. But you see the explosion, they'd already had explosion when you'd already seen it. It's so fast. So we got to know that was happening. And then I was sent over to battalion headquarters. They wanted people there. And I still had my Sten gun, and there was a guy from Charlie Company. Because what happened is that Pete Enns and his carriers are told to load up, so we couldn't go with them. They had to put ammo on. They're going into the C Company because they're out of ammo. But on the way into C Company, they were fired upon, and a grenade landed on my brother's lap. And Butch Milhausen was sitting across from him. He picked a grenade up and threw it over the side. It landed in a doorway where the German soldier was standing. It probably exploded there. And when he got to the corner, Pete Enns said to Jack, get over, look around the corner to see what's there. So he looked around the corner, and he came face to face with a German soldier, and he ran back to the carrier. The German soldier must have ran back too.
So it sounds like
kind of startling.
You're already partially, if not fully surrounded by the 26 SS.
Yeah, when he got in there, they got in there, there's a group of people, and this, Jimmy Keir is one of them, and Pete Enns says, get loaded up. He says, we're surrounded here, and let's get the hell out. So they all jumped in, and but there's no room. Jimmy Keir and his other fellow said, you guys go, we'll cover you. So they on the way back, went back, and they were fired on quite a bit. Meanwhile, one of the guys and myself were picked by the battalion headquarters, said there's snipers along that bush leading out from behind them. And I said, I've only got one mag. So we end up getting 5 mags each for Sten gun. And we went in and we hedgehog. He took a turn of going forward and spraying the trees, and I took a turn going forward spraying the trees. We ran out of ammo, and the smart thing was to not run out of ammo, keep that last magazine. We didn't do that, too dumb. So what happened is he said, I'll go back for more ammo. But he'd gone back, I forget how long, and I thought, geez, I'm not going to stay here by myself. And I heard these people talking, and I realized it didn't sound quite right. I could see through the bush about, I was in the middle of this hedge. It was about 8 or 9 feet in each side, and it looked like the SS German soldiers. So I knew the canned Scots were behind us. I thought, I'm taking off back down the bush, which I did do. And I got to the end of the bush, there's an open field, and then a Brigade farm, but there's all kinds of shells landing in the field. And I thought, well, I didn't want to get caught by these guys. You know, you kind of you're frightened getting caught. So I dashed right through that barrage, never got hit. The shells were popping all over the place, never got hit. And I got to this stone fence, and this guy, they threw the ladder over the fence. It's about 10 or 12 feet high. I got pictures to show you later. And I climbed up, and the guy, the Canadian Scottish fellow, he said, could I have your Sten gun? We're going into attack in 10 minutes. But I said, well, it's all I've got. He said, well, I'll give you my rifle for your Sten gun. I said, well, I picked it up on the beach anyway, so you can have the Sten gun, but there's no ammo. He said, I'll get the ammo. And apparently there's a lot happening up at the front. Three companies were, because of the situation was they weren't properly sighted, field of fires, but they end up being surrounded like cookie. I said, what happened when you got captured? He says, I was there, and then one fellow, first thing you know, this guy said, get out of there, Tommy. German soldiers all around him. So he said, just like that. He said, never at that time, he said, never got a chance to get scared or anything extra. He said, German soldiers, you drop your weapons, and that was it. And so he's one of the ones who was captured. The next day, they're marching along with a bunch of soldiers who were captured, Brits and others. And you couldn't, when they had German soldiers that were escorting them. And if any machine gun, anybody come over with the plane, if anybody heading for the ditch, you can be shot. That was the orders. You ought to stay on the road regardless, but even though they could go in the ditch. So this happened. And it was a U.S. Air Force guy come over, and he shot them up. And one of the NCOs got in the middle of the road and started waving his jacket. And apparently that stopped him from firing, and he come back and he waved his gun. But meanwhile, a lot of guys were hurt. Jimmy Keir, my friend, he was killed. Cookie got hit in the leg, and a couple of other wounds in the shoulder, and so on. And they say he lost his leg.
All told, that Puteau for that first Puteau, battalion.
That was a...
So this is about 150 of your regiment, so A, B, and C companies,
yeah.
First battalion.
Yeah.
They're all captured.
Right, but
save a few, including yourself.
When I was in that Brigade farm, the Catholic Can Scots, Wilder, they made their attack 10 minutes later, but a lot of our own people were drifting back. They got away from they managed to escape. And they come drifting back to the Brigade farm. And then the whole regiment ended up coming back there. I can't tell you what day, but I remember the sergeant major sitting on the side of sitting on the side of the truck, running board. He had a list of 75 people that would come in as recruits, as reinforcements. He said, I got all these, I don't even know who they are or where they went. He said, they come in last night. He said, they always shuffled around and never got to see them, but it ticked them off. And he said, I don't know who they are or what's left of them. I think it was Sergeant Major Godfrey. He's the guy that was sitting on the edge of that running board. With that, because yeah. I told them that we had one or two guys put in our trenches. He said, you know their names? I said, I don't know their names, just what they look like. Just recruits, just reinforcements.
How many of the Royals were murdered June 8th?
56. Yeah.
56.
And I think there's another six from the Can Scots, some engineers in Monterey. And you know the story of Fred Hodge, the company commander. He was one of the, they marched them all back in the woods at the Showhead Road. That's where Lieutenant Glasgow was, and I forget the other guy was. He was sort of blonde, he got hurt. But because he was blonde, they mistook him for a German, and they kept him among the German wounded. And he was a witness to what happened. And he took some to the back of the woods. And one officer, they asked him, they told him they wanted information. He said, we can only give you a name, rank, and serial number. He says, they persisted in getting more. And so they took the pistol, and they right in the forehead. That was Major Hodge. They shot him.
Right, so this was company commander?
Company commander, yeah.
Major Hodge.
And a few others.
Was he C company?
I think a C company, and 14 of them shot in Chateau at Rim. If you look at the casualties for Normandy, 10,000 for Americans, 17 for the Brits, and plus 22,000 for the Canadians. So you can see where all the dirty fighting was going on. We would have had more had they been running reinforcements. Most of the time we were going with four and five people in a section instead of nine and ten. So had they been up to strength, our casualties would have been higher. That's a negative way of thinking of it. But.
And the Canadian 7th and 9th Brigades were the first of the Allied armies in France to see action against these fanatical elite German army units, including the 12th SS.
Yeah.
So the Canadian army, they were engaged in courageous combat against these forces in the immediate hours following the D-Day landings.
Yeah.
Carpiquet, this is an airport
around
Caen. This is Operation Windsor, a Canadian operation. This was set to commence around 0500 hours on July 4.
Yeah.
General Keller, this is his audacious attack, led by the Canadian 8th Brigade with elements of the 7th to take Carpiquet Airfield from the defending 12th SS. This was originally a D-Day objective for the Canadians. What can you tell me about your mortar platoon's experience before being knocked unconscious this day?
Well, after Brigade Farm, we went to a place called Bray to lick our wounds and get reinforcements. And one day, my brother came over and he says, there's a pal of yours just down the hedgerow dug in. Why don't you go and see him? And he told me who it was, Izzy Freeman. So Izzy Freeman we got to talk to each other. I met him at when our school burned down in the 30s. We became friends at the school, and we played baseball during the summer. But I never saw him again because I ended up joining the Army in September until this day in Bray, which is in June 44. And we got to be quite friends. We went on patrol a couple times, and we laid a few mines. And then we went to Carpiquet, and we were dug in. We got mortars back, but they couldn't give us any carriers, so they give us two 1,500 weights instead of a carrier. So we were set up our mortars there, but it was set for a bit of shelling. It wasn't too bad the first night, and the sergeant said, go into the town, Marcellette, and see if there's any getting any wine at the tavern. So I snuck over to where the wine was, and I met a member of the Chaudiers who could speak French. He said, the guy said to me that the Germans cleaned them out, and then the Canadians found out where he hid the rest of the wine, and they cleaned them out. And I see, he said, there's none left. So on the way back, I'm going by these trenches, and this guy said, Parksy, and it was Izzy Freeman. So I jumped in the trench, and we chatted a while, so I said, I better get back. So I went a little bit further, another guy hollered, Parksy, and he said, where are you going? I said, looking for wine. He said, jump in. So I jumped in this trench. And he made his trench, he covered it with sheets, white sheet. And on one side of the sheet, he had a cutoff of the flap made of the sheet. He lifted up and he had three bottles of wine tucked into the side of the trench. So he gave me a snort of wine and he said, take the rest of the bottle back. That was Poppeton, Corporal Poppeton. And I got out and I got back to the sergeant. I said, I took another little slug and I said, here's some wine. And so the next day, we were preparing to go, and then they went into action, and both these guys were killed in action the next day. Izzy Freeman, he was the son of a ragman. The ragman is a guy who went around the neighborhood and picked up old rags and bottles and so on, and they had a rickety old horse. You can count his ribs and everything else. And so when I wrote up a little anecdote from him, I have Izzy Freeman, son of a ragman, killed in action 4th of July, 1944.
By the 9th of July, so about 5 days after this operation commences, 8th Brigade would eventually capture the airport.
Yeah, but you figure the casualties on D-Day, 133, 256 at Putot. So no wonder in Bray we got all these new guys, and then we lose another 89 at Carpiquet. So no wonder the 3rd Div had to come back and get reinforced and everything else. And we're up against, when you figure out who we're up against at the time, the 12th SS with tanks. They started out with 190 tanks, and the 2nd Panzer Lehr Division.
What was the experience like for your regiment in Caen? And I understand the battalion was under harassing mortar and artillery fire this time.
Yeah, they were. We end up going into what they call a caserne, which is a barracks, the main area. And we used to go in there to use the latrines. They had Germans that had as a barracks, and they had the latrines there. And actually the latrines were a hole in the ground with 2 footprints on each side, and we laughed at this, you know. It was better than digging a hole in the ground anyway, so that's what normally do. But that's just one thing. While we're in Normandy, we seem to get a lot of dysentery. A lot of dysentery, and that means you had to jump out of your trench and dig a hole, right? Because a lot of times you couldn't go back. Normally you would say, build a latrine back there and all that, but you didn't have time to go back. You'd find a convenient spot, dig a hole, do what you had to do in a real hurry, get back to your trench, you know? And you just take off your boots to change, and that was it. Change your socks. And one of the ways you'd wash your socks, and one way to keep, used to keep them getting dry, you put them underneath your tunic against your body. And that way you'd have a fresh pair of socks. We have 56 days in the line. In World War I, you were in the line for 2 weeks and taken out. That was our schedule. 2 weeks in the line and taken out. We were 56 days in the line without take. They kept pumping in reinforcements and taking the dead out and wounded out and so on. That was another thing you had to do too. The pad, we'd always need help finding bodies, and a lot of times you'd just find the bodies in fields, you'd get the rifle and the bayonet, and you put the helmet on top. And if you find German soldiers, well, I used to put the German soldiers' helmet on them. You see that, especially around about, just after Putot, we went forward for another village, and on the way back, the people behind us have identified all the dead by the rifles and the helmet, and it seemed like this whole field was full of rifles and helmets, both German and Canadian. That's a thing I'll never forget. We were at Warschoot, Belgium, a place called Warschoot, and we had nice hours. We were 2 weeks there, and we had an hour and a half for lunch, and we're only 2 blocks from downtown Warschoot. And there was a pub there ran by Roger Ducorte. He wore the yellow sweater on the Tour de France 3 times, and he had pictures on the wall. And at that time, there were no Americans to be near Belgium, so consequently, you can get a shot of liquor for a franc and a half. So we go there and have a couple of 2-3 shots at lunchtime. And Taxi Davies, there was another guy we nicknamed called Taxi, because every time he had a few drinks, he'd want to call for a taxi. So instead of him having one or two, he'd have one more for the road. And he said, we got to get going, one more for the road. So he'd have about 6 for the road, and we'd have to help him back. So when they fall on parade for the right marker, that means one guy walks out, marches out, and then everybody says fall in on the marker. So when they called right marker, even though he wasn't named because he had so many ones for the road, he marched out to be a marker as well. They have to drag him back because he was kind of stoned, you know. But that was a Leopold Canal. Well, what happened to poor old Taxi Davies? He was a pioneer platoon. They're probing for mines and it blew both his arms off. So that's a little anecdote about the Leopold Canal. And the story was that hell was hot, but one of the guys said, no, it's not hot. It's cold, and it's miserable, and it's wet, and it's the Leopold Canal. I ended up going to Nijmegen. About that time, they're in Nijmegen. And during the winter, they'd pick positions out and we'd have targets. And we took over from the Essex Scottish on the 28th of December. And they said, you gotta be careful here. If you fire, they keep firing back at you. We said, okay. And as soon as they left, we fired 10 rounds rapid fire and ran into the house and they fired back. And then on New Year's Eve, New Year's Eve, I think at Christmas Eve, we always fired, this is six mortars firing, 10 rounds rapid fire, bam, 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 and hit it. So 60, we picked different targets each. So we didn't believe in not silent. We fired as many as we could, you know. That winter was a kind of nasty winter. A lot of things happened. The one group that they sent out with a carrier and a trailer to go across this plain, which had been flooded, but there's a road there, and there's troops at the far end. But they were in a hurry and they lost control, and it tipped the carrier and the trailer into the water, and seven guys were pinned under. So we were within an hour, we were over there digging them, getting them out of the water. And then the Pabby showed up, he took the tags off, we wrapped them in the blanket. And one 1500, we waited for 1500 we to show up. And we stacked them three between the wheel hubs and four on top. And then we all jumped in and we buried them at the, I think somewhere in Grosbeak Cemetery.
When did you return to Normandy after the war, and what are some of the things that you would reflect on? You visit Corsorsemer, and
yeah,
where you landed at Mike Green.
Yeah, Mike, right? Green.
Mike Green.
Yeah, B Company. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
What do you think about when you go back there and look out at?
There's
the
nothing
beach?
You can see there, and you're trying to conjure up the memory, and it's easy to conjure. You think about the mortars, you think about the running. The only way you have your thoughts is when you go to the cemeteries and you see, if you go into Beni-sur-Mer and you go to the left side, you see whole rows of Winnipeg Rifles, Regina Rifles, because they're all people from D-Day, Bretville and Putot and the 9th Brigade area, they're all strung out there.